Hi, everybody. My name is Brandon Sheffield. I kind of helped coordinate this panel and bring it here. So I'm glad you're all here to see this super rare opportunity, because these guys aren't usually the ones talking about Sonic. And it's really great to hear their perspective on the beginnings of this series that has sold millions and is one of the biggest franchises in the world, and how this started from nothing to become the giant monolith that it is today. So they're going to do their own intros. We have Yasuhara-san, who did all the maps and game design, and we have Oshima-san, who did all of the visual designs and other things. So after this, after they go through their sessions, I will ask them a couple of questions, and we'll have a little fun treat at the end of it, and then we'll open up the floor a little bit. And I know that a lot of people are probably going to want to get signatures and things like that, and we're probably going to have to take that outside to the wrap-up room. I'm just going to let you know that in advance. And so let's just go ahead and get started. Yasuhara-san.
Oh, okay. Wow. Yeah. Thank you for coming. So I'm really glad to, you know, have such kind of the you know, very rare opportunity to share my, you know, our experiences to make the you know, characters in the game characters. So thank you for coming. So I appreciate it. So, and first of all, so this one. Okay.
There we go.
So my name is Hirokazu Yasuhara. I've worked on the kind of, you know, the game industry more than 30 years. Oh, 英語喋ってるか、そこ。え、日本語の方がいいね。あ、ごめんなさい。あの、日本語喋ります。
どっちでもいいですよ。
はい、はい。じゃあ、次行きます。はい、じゃあ、大島さん。
大島です。
Hi, everyone. I'm Oshima.
はい。
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
はい、はい、今日のセッションですけど、3つのことを話します。
So today's session, we're going to have to sort of stick to these three big topics, but I promise there's a lot to cover.
そうですね、まあ、読んでくればいいんですけど、ソニックの始まる背景と、ゲームに関する話と、あと、まあ、ソニックを作った結果の話ですね。
So the beginnings and the origins of Sonic, anecdotes about the game, and of course the result, what happened once we created Sonic.
はい、じゃあいきます。始まりですね、まあ、1990年代の初めですね、セガは8ビットマシンの、競争では、まあ、NES に負けていたわけですね。はい、
So as you can see here, in 1990, Sega wanted to, wanted a next generation character that could stand up to the NES and Mario. We were not able to compete in the 8-bit console consumer market with it, so we had to come up with something.
まあ、その頃キャラクターってものは、まあ、ゲームごとに、まあ、使い捨てられているような形で、まあ、マーケティングなんかも何も考えずに、まあ、大事にされてなかったわけですね。
But I think it's fair to say that Sega did not, value characters and their worth, very highly in terms of how marketable they could be. Instead, they kind of treated characters as something that was created, used, and then disposed.
ですね。だからセガも、まあ、そのこれから長く使えるようなキャラクターを、まあ、作れたらいいなという思いがずっと持っていたわけです。
So the thinking was coming sort of, shifting a little bit. The company was wanting something that could be representative of the company, let it be iconic, and have a longer sort of lifespan.
ですね。で、なぜヘッジホッグかということなんですが。
And so then the question is, why a hedgehog then?
転がって、まあ、スピードをつけて攻撃できるキャラクターという、まあ、仕様があったんですね。
So a character that can deal damage by curling up like a ball, roll around at a very fast pace.
だから ヘッジホッグ以外にもたくさんのこうアイデアがあったんです実は。
Yeah, as you can see at the very bottom, old guy with a mustache, the one that became the Eggman, that was even one of the ideas as well.
はい、そこで大島さん。
あのそれでですね、そのまあ会社の方からは、ちょっとヒゲの親父を、作ってくれだとか、でそれとハリネズミとあと犬のキャラクターを持ってちょうど自分がニューヨークに遊びに行く時がありまして、プラカードを持って、セントラルパークでみんなにこうアンケートを取ったんですね。でそうするとそのハリネズミが一番人気で、で2位がそのヒゲオヤジだったんですけど、それでもうこれヘッジホッグしかないなというところで、まあなんでしょうね、なんかやっぱり人種に関係なく、ソニックを選んでくれたっていうところがやはり大きかったかなと思います。はい。
So there's actually a really, I don't know, a nostalgic, I guess, story or episode here. I planned a trip to New York, while this discussion was going on internally. And so, the company and we were talking and they said, you know what?we definitely want to see something like an old guy with a mustache as an idea. We also want to see something that's sort of spiky, a hedgehog or even a porcupine. And then we also want to see a dog-like or dog character. And so I drew these on a board and I am in the middle of Central Park. This is a true story. And I'm showing people these three boards randomly, taking a survey. And the result was is that the hedgehog was the most popular. People really pointed at it and liked it. Second was actually Eggman. and then third was the dog. And so I was like, wow, this is you know, kind of surprising or a pleasant surprise. And so I was asking myself, I wonder why it is. And the conclusion to me, without, you know, having nailed like one single answer, to me, what was more convincing was that by a lot of people choosing the hedgehog, that meant that it will transcend race and just different types of people, gender, everything. And so I brought back that result with me and reported it back to the company.
そうですね。はい。で、まあキャラクターデザインの話なんですけれども、まあいいキャラクターっていうのはすごい単純な線で作られてるなっていう思いをずっと持ってました。
So as you can see here, character composed of lines so simple you could draw as part of a sing-along song, like when we had the song playing. You know, we feel like a great character can be easily sort of sketched or drawn with just a simple sort of few lines here and there.
だから例えば子供がこう、
俺んとこじゃない。
どうぞ、はい。
とにかくこんな感じでですね、私が作ってる横でうるさいんですね。横でうるさい。
So I think that was my part. So I'm going to take over from here. But Yasuhara-san is always sort of like bugging me from the side like this and wanting to talk about these things. But let me talk a little bit about the process here.
そうなんです。で、ソニック自身はすごく何でしょう、独自性を持ったキャラクターにしたいと思ってはいなかったんです。どこかで見たようななんか安心できるキャラクターを目指してまして、ただそのつながった目とそのブルーのハリネズミっていう部分が特徴があれば、できるだけその安心できて、なんかなんだろう、こうわすげえっていう風な感じのキャラクターにはしたくはなかったです。ただもう本当に安原がその簡単に誰でも描けるようにしてほしい、してほしいってうるさかったので、もう安原はお前自分で描けと、で描かした絵がすごい気に入ったんで、それをまた使っていくことになるんですけど、じゃあそこから安原にタッチします。
So, As you can see here, we said, you know, we wanted a character kids could draw. Just simple. But first and foremost, in creating this character, we didn't want it to be so foreign and like almost too pronounced where it was not familiar. We wanted that level of familiarity and even a level of kind of comfort that you would be able to kind of have, you know, a quick sort of relationship, like build a relationship, be an affectionate character for you. So the point was to make it into a character that feels familiar. You've maybe seen a figure or a silhouette or someone or a character or an animal that looks like what became Sonic. But there are points that we wanted to focus on, and those are the connected eyes and him being blue. And then obviously we thought, okay, we haven't seen anything like this. And then we added the pupils and then balanced it in a way that felt right, so that there was at least some level of kind of uniqueness and individuality. So all throughout this process, Yasuhara-san is like, no, but it needs to be simple enough so that anyone can draw it. I want like little kids to be able to mimic and draw our character.
で、まあ、要するに子供たちが描いてて自然にそのキャラクターになるようなのが理想だなと思ってて、で、僕はこのキャラクターをこんな風に描いたわけです。
So, because I was thinking that way, I was like, okay, I want it to be simple enough and draw. So you see obviously the end result on the left-hand side, but the simple drawing that I drew looked like that.
で、これをずっと使って企画も描いてました。
So that's the version that I used with any of the sketches. If I was sort of, you know, doing some map design or anything, that's the version of Sonic that I consistently used.
Ah, でですね、私もこのキャラクターすごい気に入ってですね、日本の取説にこのキャラクターをバンバン載せています。
And yeah, it's cute. So I fell in love with it too. And we didn't let it go to waste. We used it a lot in the owner's manual, the instructions manual that came in the Japanese version of the games.
そうですね。まあ、次、じゃあキャラクターなんですけれども、まあ、セガのキャラクターにするためにはですね、やっぱりもうそれを見た瞬間にセガだって分かんなくてはいけないと思うんですね。
So although this statement here may sound very as a matter of fact, but the biggest challenge for us, because we didn't have those characters that had a long lifespan, the challenge was that we needed to overcome, you know, what needs to be done to create a character that represents Sega, the company, the brand.
だからセガを全部載せるようなキャラクターじゃないといけないと。
So this character really had to kind of carry the entire weight, you know, on its shoulder and say, okay, yes, I am Sega. Like, I can define what Sega is by seeing this character.
どういうことかというと、まあ、例えば、なぜソニックは青いのかということですけれども、僕の中ではもう、なぜならセガのロゴが青いから。
Again, as a matter of fact, but, it, you know, we didn't have to really...Take a look at any other colors. Why is Sonic blue? Because that was Sega's brand color.
そうですね。はい。で、まあ、まあ、いろんないいことがあるわけですね。動物のキャラクターにするとですね、まあ、自由なこう世界を広げていけるというか、いろんな使い方ができるということですね。
And then here we have listed some of the merits of having a fictional animal character.As the character that represents the brand, there's always some, you know, there's it's not always pluses and sort of upsides, but we found a few that made sense for us here.
で、まあ見た瞬間にこう誰でも分かりますし、まあ宣伝するにも、そのキャラクターがもう会社名は知らなくてもキャラクターは知ってるっていうようなことにもなるし。その後キャラクターのビジネスにもつながるということで、はい。
Yeah, and so we wanted, like I said earlier, there needs to be a little bit of that unique originality, but still be, you know, somewhat familiar. I think the important thing for us was that it represented the company, And even if someone didn't remember the company name, that they would quickly associate the character with that company. And then another factor was that we can turn this character basically into a business of its own. So, for example, merchandise, etc.
で、あの、まあ、セガの、まあ、リプレゼントするんだから、この、まあ、ハイコンセプトがいろいろあるわけですけれども、そのうちでこう3つ大切なものがありました。
So there were three sort of pillars that we went by, in coming up with, what is in line with Sega's what we call high concepts.
はい。で、まあ、かっこよさと、まあ、チャレンジャーであることと、まあ、あとヒストリーというところですね。
So those three are here, that it's cool.That it has a kind of challenger spirit, and that there's history or background to the character.
で、僕らはあのマインドマップを作ったわけですけれども、まあセガのイメージっていろんなこうキーワードが出てきたわけですね。
And so, as you can see here, we call it a mind map of Sega. All these keywords, that sort of express or describe our brand values, and philosophies.
それで、まあ、まあ、このかっこいいっていう言葉がとてもそう作るならどうせならかっこいいものを作ろうよっていうことで考え始めました。
And so obviously we picked the right word that's in red, cool. And based on that, we went to work.
これですね。かっこいいってなんだろうっていうことをすごくあのその時みんなで考えたんですね。
And you know, cool is a nice word, but how do you define cool? Like everyone's definition of cool could be pretty different.
うん、かっこいいは形とか、まあ、表面的なことではなくて、まあ、このようなこうアティテュードみたいなものが伴わないといけないんだろうということになりました。
So cool can be something that is more on the surface, visual, visually sort of.I guess expressive or expressing or just cool character design, but that wasn't the cool that we were looking for. And so there were all these factors on the right hand side. It was more about the attitude of coolness and bringing that somehow into the character design.
ああ、で、ちょっと私の方でこだわったのが媚びないキャラクター。ここにちょっと書いてないんですけど。そのかっこよさっていうところを媚びないっていうところに、焦点を置いてなんかみんなをにらみつけてるような表情が生まれた感じです
ね。そうなんですね。So another thing that we, in addition to this, is that a substantive sort of coolness, it says here, is that I wanted it to be, what would you call it? That you wouldn't be, I guess, sort ofafraid or sort of fearful, or it wouldn't kind of lose its coolness. And so when it's looking at you, or when the fans or the users are looking at the facial expression of Sonic, that it would be kind of, you know, have a stare or like a cool attitude. That's a trademark. So that's something that I really wanted to show through its kind of stare, I guess.
ですね。まあ、だからあの性格を作るとあのキャラクターってものがよりこう立ってくるということが言われますね。
So I wanted the characteristic of Sonic to really come out or stand out from that sort of attitude that we were trying to create.
でもう一つがですね、あの二つ目がセガはチャレンジャーであったということですね。
So the second one is that Sega is a challenger or has that challenger spirit.
でちょうどその頃にですね、9年代始めてあの、まあ、エコブームというかエコロジー大切だね、環境が大切だねってことが言われ始めた頃でした。
So there's I guess some elements that were elements and atmosphere as it says here that was kind of happening in the early 90s.、
うん、ですね。まあ、バナナリパブリックとかですね、まあ、アースカラーやエコロジー系のファッションも流行ってきた時期ですね、は
い、And yeah, not just restricted to our industry or tech or software, but even in the worlds of fashion and kind of like eco-friendly an eco-friendly, environmentally sort of like, I guess, conscious sort of fields of businesses, there was all this movement going on.
まあ、だからあのゲームの世界もですね、まあ、自然と、まあ、環境開発の対立みたいなものがこう取り入れることになりました。
So how that's, I guess, tied back into what we were doing as game companies and game creators, it was, I can say that it was kind of an era where we began to think about our environment a little bit more.
まあ、これがあの、まあ、ソニックの、まあ、ロボットとの戦いっていうことのベースになってますね。
And that sort of idea is, as a result, was kind of rooted into this slide you see here. So in our game world, we use the idea of nature versus environmental development.、
うん、はい。じゃあ3つ目です。で、まあ、歴史ですね。あの、他のキャラクターには歴史があると。はい。
And the third element is that we talked about, we wanted to have the character to, have its own history or background.
はい。で、僕らはですね、あの、こういう歴史ってものがオリジナルキャラクターにはないので、まあ、どうにかしなきゃいけないなということですね。こう、フィクションのストーリー作ろうよと、フィクションリスあれ作ろうよという話になりました。
So, if you look at these other, I guess, series or very well-known character sets or families, you know, these characters have their own world, they have their own story, they have their own background. In the meantime, we don't have anything. We're just trying to come up with a character here. So we thought about having or giving the character its own history.
だからセガはあの昔そのジュークボックスやピンボールをアメリカから輸入して作っあの輸入してたって会社なのでそういうヒストリーはあるんですね。
On the other hand, as a company, there was history. Sega was a company that imported American jukeboxes and pinball machines.、
うん、でここであのじゃあどうしようってアメリカが出てくるんですけれども、そこでこう大島さんがあのたくさんのこう飛行機のノーズアートの、アートブックとかを持っていたんですね。
And while it may not be a direct connection from what I just said, there is an element of, you know, American culture and importing parts of these businesses, and so.That led to Oshima-san's interest that he had at that time, airplane nose art, emblems, and leather jackets.
そうですね。で、大島さんとかね、こういうようなことをあの言ってました。
So then we use that as a base for coming up with this story and trying to develop a convincing enough or a colorful enough kind of story as to how we can land this character to have this story that's connected to something that Oshima-san is really into.
そうですね。で、あの、僕が話を考えました。
And then that's when I came in and actually wrote the story for him.
あれだよ最初は俺だからね
はいどうぞ
じゃあ違う、うん、あの、うん、一人で考えたわけじゃない
あ、まあ、もちろんそうですよ、うん、はいそうですねはいで何書いてあるかというとこんな感じですねまあハリネズミというもうあだ名のパイロットがいてですね、その人が乗っていたそのノーズアートにハリネズミが書かれていたとでその彼の奥さんがハリネズミの童話を書きましたと。で、彼はそのハリネズミのキャラクターがもを、まあ、縫い付けたあのエンブレムをあのジャケットを着ていましたっていう話なんですね。
So I don't think I need to translate it, but this is basically the gist of the story that I came up with.
そうですね。
And the slide earlier was really like put into an actual like scenario form to make it legit before presenting it to the company.
そうですね。まあ、まあ、戻るとだからこのパイロットと
Here it is.
その奥さんが書いたストーリーがソニック。だから実はソニックの1の話というのはこの彼女が書いた童話の話なんですね。
So yeah, Sonic, for one, the story in there is that it's connected to this background story the author, she, the premise is that she actually wrote the story that you see in Sonic 1. So it's all kind of connected.
Connected.
この絵は、あ、さっきの絵は私が描いてます。
そうです。
どの絵ですか？あの、一個前の。
一個前。
これ、これね。
Okay. So this, yeah, this is, this was drawn by Oshima-san.
Oshima-san が描きました。はい。懐かしいですね。
懐かしい。
はい。
Brings back a lot of memories for us.
そう。で、だからですね、こう、ソニックは、あの、エンブレムを、がついてるんです。
And that's why I think now that you know a little bit about the story that we wrote for coming up as Sonic, the emblem on this leather jacket or the flight jacket, it really goes well with the story that we developed. And I think you can, you know, instantly sort of recognize that feel as well.
この絵はその時の当時の私が描いた絵なんですよね。
そのまま？
そのまま。
So this is exactly...The art or the illustration that I drew at that time, as is.
ですね。はい。そうですね。こんな感じですね。はい。はい、次、まあ、ゲームの話ですね。
あの、So yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about the game now.
で、あの、新しい技術というものが16ビット機になって、あの、使えるようになりました。
Yeah, with the new technology, obviously we were, moving on to 16-bit games.
はい。で、まあ、スムースな、まあ、ジオメトリーというか、地形と、まあ、あれですね、まあ、すごい速いスピードで動けるということと、あと、大きなものを動かすということですね。
And what that allowed us to do, not just us, but the generation at that time, it pushed us into so many different directions, as you see here, the smoother geography, tricks to convey the feeling of speed, much faster sensation of speed, and then lots of larger objects and moving objects.
でこれっていうのは誰もができることじゃなくて、あの、中さん、中裕二という、まあ、プログラマー天才プログラマーですけど、彼が、あの、ハードウェアの本当に奥の方までもう叩くような作り方をして実現していることです。
So we can now say, looking back, that that was the technology that became available. But it wasn't that everyone, all the game developers at that time, was able to really take full advantage of what was about to become available. We truly think that Naka-san,was front and center in trying to figure out how can we best utilize the technology that we have now and try to get all this, try to extract the end result from the hardware that we have sitting right in front of us. So I think it was a very special moment for us to see that really come to life.
で、まあ、そういうことができるということで、いろんな、あの、アイデアを考えました。
So based on that, these are just some of, some examples that we came up with. It's like, now we can do this. Let's see, you know, what it looks like, how it feels like. So these are just some examples that we brought, from those days.
ですね。まあ、こういうことを試しながら、あの、作っていきました。
So we tried these out.You know, it was an iterative process, obviously, but we wanted to see how far we can take it.
そうですね。まあ、だからその当時だったマリオが、あの、まあ、練習して上手くなるゲームなら、ソニックっていうのは、まあ、どっちかっていうとセガの、まあ、体感ゲームというのがあったんですけど、もうアミューズメントテーマパークをそのまま、まあ、体験できるみたいなことを念頭に置いていろいろ考えていました。
So the biggest difference that I can say, differentiating, I guess, factor between Mario and how you played games based on Mario as a character versus Sonic is that Mario had, or games that, you know, they made were more of you play and play repeatedly and you get better. It was...skill-based, but also exploring the world in that manner. Whereas with us, it was almost like Sonic was taking you, but also you were in, thrown in an environment where it felt more of like an amusement park scenario. So you're enjoying what is around you in the environment, and Sonic is helping you sort of experience that.
ですね。で、まあ、作り方というのはですね、このようなさっきの絵ですけど、こう自分が描いてこうみんなにこう見せて、それでああでもないこうでもないということを繰り返して作ってきました。
So again, these are some design notes from back in the days. It was a very simple kind of flow. So first, what I would do is I would have these rough, quick sketches about level design, and then I would share it with our programmer and our artist. We would then discuss, you know, going back and forth, how we can do this, how we can prioritize some of these ideas and concepts and make it work. So I actually didn't really have like.Proper game design documents.
こうバッテンとかついてるのがあると思うんですが、それは今はできるかどうかわからないと言って後回しにしたアイデアです。
So the one with X's just to prove that not every idea works or can be worked on right away. The one with the X's on the right hand side, we wanted to, but we knew we just.Either couldn't or it just wasn't possible at that time. So we were going to deprioritize them for a much later time. But in the end, we were actually able to bring them back onto the table and make it work.
で、作り方ですけど、当時そんな全部入るわけじゃないので、64枚のパーツを組み合わせて、3種類のマップを作りました。
So here's another example, an actual sort of level map and how we drew them and assembled them. So due to obviously the memory restrictions of the hardware, I can only use sets of 64 parts or panels for each of the zones. And then I would build three unique levels with those parts.
だけど、バックグラウンドにも8枚青いところがブルーラインで書かれているのがバックグラウンドで取られちゃうので、そんな全部使えるわけではないんですね。
But as you can see, you know, the blue frame part that says background, I wouldn't be able to use all of it because of the part on top that you see there.
こういうところでは、ループでは2枚も使ってしまうわけで。
はい。There you go. Yeah, now highlighting the top level.
で、トンネルには。
The tunnel.
2枚使ってしまう。
And then I would end up using two more for the tunnel.
はい。で、エネミーもそうです。エネミーも同じような形で次から次へと考えてもう作ってきました。
Same with the enemy designs. They seem like, you know, just rough ideas sketched. But it was a very similar process. I would just make rough, quick notes.And then draw these sketches, how they looked, how they act, what kind of enemies, and then just have a discussion with the team.
で、それを見て、こう、おしさんがね、書いてくれましたね。
はい。
はい。はい、イエス。はい、外。
じゃあ、プレイヤーのアニメーションをちょっとお話しします。ドットで、まあ、書いていくんですけども、その前にスケッチブックにいっぱいこういうふうな絵をいっぱい描いて、どう少ないパターンで動きをつけなきゃいけないので、スケッチブックでこういうものをいっぱい描いて、でこれでいけそうだなっていうものをドットで描いていきました。
So I'm going to talk just a little bit about the animations for the player character.Pretty simple, but you know, before reproducing my ideas using pixels, what I would do is in my sketchbook, I would draw these that you see here. But knowing that the animations needed to work in a pretty sort of small volume, I would just iterate and draw a lot up front before reproducing them in pixels.
いいですか。次のところ、はい、
次、同じような感じで、これはエッグマンですけど、とにかく私別にアニメーターではなくてですね、そんなにそういうアニメの勉強を してこなかったので、もうこの当時はいっぱいいろんなアニメだとか映画とかを見て、コマ送りしながら あ、こうすればいいのかなとかっていうのをスケッチブックにいっぱい書いてるような感じでした。
So with Eggman or any of the really, other non-player characters, it was the same situation or the same flow. I did not have any experience as an animator, nor did I do any studies in animation. So really, I had to spend a lot of time watching anime or watching film and kind of scrubbing back and forth and seeing how it's done. And so all of that learning, I wanted to first lay it out in sketch form before producing them and moving forward in pixels. So these are some of the actual examples that I drew at that time.
はい。で、このスケッチブックなんですが、その中でこのダンスのか、まあこういう絵が実は通常のプレイのシーンよりも山ほど描いててまして、で実はそれを私全部作ってました。でゲーム中に入れる予定だったんですが、その4メガに入らなかったんですね。
So, this is the dancing or dance animation that I was really kind of committed and strongly wanting to put in the game. I thought it was a nailed thing and, and sadly though, it didn't make it into the game. It just didn't fit, you know, capacity-wise into the game. So unfortunately, we never got to see the dance animation. The fabled dance animation that no one ever got to see in the game.
どっかにあるんでしょうね。はい、
はい、
以上で。で、まあマーケティングのエフォートってやつですね。まあソニックは91年の冬にこう向けて作られたわけですけれども、なぜかというとその時にこうSNES ですね、スーパーファミコン、スーパーNESが出るっていうことになっていたので、そこにぶつけようということですね。でスーパーNESは、まあ、マリオがついて$199、かたやあのソニックがジェネシスはソニックをつけて$149ってことですね。でこれで、まあ、比較広告を非常にいっぱい打ったわけですね。
So here we have really a high-level summary of some of the marketing efforts and campaigns that were happening at that time. I don't know if any of you in the audience remember 1991 in this manner. Oh, you do. Oh, good. Small amount, though, I think. but basically, yeah, the Super NES was going for $199 with Super Mario World bundled in it. And then for Sega, it was bundled with the Genesis, and Sonic 1 was bundled at a $50 sort of lower price point. And so we considered that was kind of like the holiday sales war of 1991.
So the result is... そうですね。はい。じゃあ僕らの思うことが、まあ、実現したということですね。
So all of our this to us means that all of our blood, sweat, and tears, and everything that we put into building Sonic as a character, but really, putting Sega, you know, out there, having that brand recognition and being able to beat Nintendo Super NES and the Mario bundle meant a whole lot. It was something that we had hoped and wished for and worked hard towards, and it actually happened.
ですね。はい。で、まあ、ラップアップですけど、僕らがこのソニックを通じて、学んだことっていうのが、まあ、3つぐらいありまして、一つ目がですね、まあ、どんな強そうに見える敵でも戦う方法はあるんだということですね。
So here's a summary of our experience and learnings, but I think they can be applied to a lot of different things. The first thing is there's always going to be ways to compete with what you think are unbeatable opponents.
二つ目がですね、 テクノロジーをもう味方につけるってことですね。
And the second one is making technology your ally.
はい。で、まあ新しいテクノロジーというのはですね、まあ古い、まあ、世代というか、それまでの世代と戦うのにとても有効な武器と、その世代の有効な武器になると思います。
And what I mean by that is, you know, anyone can go out and try to make use of new technology, but more than that, I think it's a tool that can be used to sort of beat out an opponent that had always had the number one position up until that point. It's more difficult for companies or people in that position to make that change happen. So new technology kind of becomes a weapon or a tool for those who want to go up for that challenge.
はい。で、まあ、3つ目がですね、仲間を集めようということですね。
And the third one is gathering allies, like getting a band together.
僕らは一人一人が、まあ、こういろんなことを言い合いながら、このゲームを作っていきました。
So us, you know, we were a team, but individually we were very, I guess, opinionated and spoke our minds. And those moments, you know, you're speaking about what your ideas are, but we came together as a band.
本当にバンドみたいなもので、誰かがフレーズを弾いたら、それに誰かが何かを乗っけて、でそうだったらこうしようっていうのを次々に重ねていくと、すごく自分では想像もできないような素晴らしいものができるですね。
So in a way, we were individually having these solo performances or solo acts, but once I projected my solo part, then someone else reacted to that, and then another person reacted to that. And there's infinite sort of possibilities if you look at it that way. Something that you can't imagine just by yourself will happen if you have other people come together that are kind of having similar tastes and ideas and minds.
だから仲間を集ってゲームをいろんなものゲームだけじゃないですねいろんなことをやっていくととてもいいと思いますということです。
So yeah, not just in games, but whatever you are pursuing or working on, I would strongly encourage that you guys come together as a band. You know, start singing one phrase, and then another person may step into it and add to that. It'll be something that will result in.Unimaginable sort of ideas and results.
はい、ありますか。
そうですね。本当にソニックが、まあソニックに関わったメンバーともちろん中さんはもちろんのこと、それ以外にもスタッフであったり、いろんな営業だったり、いろんなスタッフの力があってソニックが生まれたと思うので、本当にみんなのそういう力が集まったっていうところが大きいので、本当にいい仲間を集めるっていうのは大切だなと感じてます。
To add and maybe reiterate, you know, it's just us two speaking today, but obviously with Naka-san being a part of the team, it was, and not just Naka-san, other staff who made things happen, not just on the development side, also on the business and sort of sales side. Because we all got together as one big team, one big band, I think the energy was exponentially sort of larger than what one person could have done or even a small amount of people could have done at that time. So that energy and power that we had at that time was so strong and stronger than ever that we had experienced before. And I think that really helped to attain and achieve our goals.
今日の場合以上です。ありがとうございました。
That's it. Thank you.
That was great. You should follow them both on Twitter if you don't already. They post a lot of good Sonic stuff. I'm going to quickly get into some questions. It was really hard not to jump in the middle. So first, was there any sense that you were working in a dream team at the time? We think of it now, but...
どうですか?夢の共演だと思ってっていう質問ですけど。
あります?
夢の共演、はい、でも やっぱり中さんがですね、一番そのもう元々偉い、まあ、部署の中でナンバーワンのプログラマーだったので、
天才プログラマー、
天才プログラマーだったので、まあ彼と仕事をするっていうことが、まあ、私の目標だったんですね。なので、そういう意味ではもう中さんと組んだ時点で絶対いいものになるぞと私は思ってました。
So I don't know if Dream Team is the label or name that I was even thinking of. Rather than that way of thinking, you know, Naka-san at that time was already a genius programmer. He was basically our number one guy, an important figure at the company. So all this time, my goal was to somehow figure out a way to work with him and to team up. And if that happens, then I know that something really good will come out of it. So that's really the only kind of thought and goal I had in mind at that time.
で、中さんと組むとですね、その部署の中でも力を得ることができてですね、優秀な企画を欲しいと思うわけですね。そこで
And not only, you know, do I get to work with Naka-san, but what comes with that structure is that you have other talented people who will end up contributing or are already contributing with what's going on in conjunction with what Naka-san's working on. And that's where Yasuhara-san comes into kind of the picture for me, because from a design point of view, he was already doing great work. So it was a win-win for me. I get to work with someone that I wanted to work with all this time, and then comes all these other talented people on the team.
その時僕はマーク・サーニーさん、さっき言いましたけど、マーク・サーニーさんと一緒に仕事してたんですよ。で、彼ももちろんもう超天才プログラマーですから、もう全然満足してたんですけど。だけど、はい、だけど、まあ、そちらも面白そうだなと、キャラクターゲーム作りたかったなということで、ジョインしましたね。
So, hearing that is nice, but I was also working with someone who I considered another genius, which was Mark Cerny. He popped in earlier a little bit, but he's on a whole different level, whole nother level. So I thought I was already surrounded by, you know, all these geniuses. And then I hear about, you know, Oshima-san being able to work with Naka-san. So I actually wanted to kind of like work more a little bit on the character design side of things. So I guess the end result is that it was a really good team that came together at that time.
And how much did Yuji Naka's practice of getting the most out of the Mega Drive influence the game design and the game's creation?
だから中さん何でも作ってくれるんですよ。何でも作れる。だから何を出しても作ってくれるっていう、それはもう夢のようなプログラマーさんと組ませてもらったっていうのは本当のところですね。
So the truth is that he rarely said like he would take on any kind of ideas and wishes. He'll be like, okay, I'll make that happen.And that in itself was like a super ideal, almost dreamlike scenario because he's like, okay, I'll see what I can do and I'll make it happen. So that was the environment that we were in at that time.
Little follow-up to Oshima-san. You once told me that when making Sonic CD, during the time transitions, they had to put in a loading screen. Mm-hmm.But you wanted it originally to be continuous, and you told me Naka-san could have done it. I just want to...
Done it, not seamless. Naka-san
だったら
絶対できたっていう話を。
でしょ？
そうです。
言えない。
いや、
言えない。
I'd rather not comment.
Okay.
Which means, I'd rather not comment.
If you read Gama Sutra, you will see that he did that. Can you talk about the creation of the music for a bit? I want to know how you got involved with discussions with Masato Nakamura, who was from Dreams Come True, a famous Japanese pop band. So I heard that he was just given static screenshots of the game, and then he composed his music on keyboards and sent it in on a demo tape.
Nakamura-san との音楽の制作のやりとりです。
1回しか会ってないんですがあのとにかくキャラクターの絵を見ただけだとなんか子供のものじゃないかっていうふうに特に日本人は思うんですけど、そのキャラクターはすごく大人の女性にもモテるしとか、決して子供のものじゃないんだっていうことを一生懸命説明させてもらって、で日本ではドリームズカムトゥルーというバンドをやってて、まあ有名だったんですけど、決してこのキャラクターを使うことによってドリームズカムトゥルーのイメージが落ちることはありませんというようなお話をさせていただきました。
So the truth is that I only met Nakamura-san once. This entire time, or as we were working on this song and asking him to create the song, there are a few things that I guess we were very careful of. If we had just sent or shared an image of the character, we feared that he would take it as more of a, let's say like a child or a kid cartoon, you know, a younger age demographic targeted game or IP. So we wanted to make sure that that was not the first impression that we gave or he took, and that we wanted this character to appeal to a wider range of audience, even including females and, you know, a higher age range, adult females. So that's one thing that we did for sure. And then also, because he was part of Dreams Come True, which is a very popular Japanese band, we had this kind of exchange or promise that by him working on creating a song for Sonic, that it wouldn't devalue the popularity of his band, just because, oh, he's now out making songs for, you know, game characters or games. So that was kind of the exchange that we had. And that's kind of as far as, you know, my, I guess, relationship or communication goes in trying to convince him to work on a song.
そしてキーボードで作ってカセットテープで送ったでしょ？
はい。
So yes, he did compose it on a keyboard, like away from Sega, and send it in on a cassette
tape.
And then they like interpreted it there into the FM synthesis. And what was the process of creating the dot art in the game? You had some specific programs and hardware?
デジタイザーという木の箱でこれぐらい大きの大きさのものに
があるんですよ。あったんですよね。
ペンライトペンでこうカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッカチッ、
うん、本当にそう。
でこれぐらい大きくこっち側のモニターに映ってこう見ながらカチッカチッカチッそんな感じで。
I think the action speaks louder than words, but basically.
But it was a touch screen, right?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Fun and additional.
They called it a digitizer, and it was like this pretty giant kind of box. And so I would, you know, be basically clicking, touching here. And then there was a monitor on the side, so I would have to kind of test check what is going on here, looking at it, and then just one by one, it was a very tedious sort of process.
これしましょうか? So here's a fun thing that we came up with for you. The both of them are going to draw their. They're going to draw their interpretation of their individual interpretations of Sonic right now.
どこから描くか。皆さんどこから書くか分かるか聞いてみて。
So I don't know if I can get a I don't know hands, but where do you think I start with? Or yeah, what part of the character do you think I start?
Okay, I'll ask. Do you think he starts with the head? Yeah. Or the shoes? The body?
全身描かなきゃいけ
ない。Or the eyes?
Eyes.
アイから描
く。Well, eyes is right.
Eyes are right.
Yeah.
この価値ですね。目です。
While he draws, I will ask Yasuhara-san.
はい。
Can you quickly describe your the main points of your game design philosophy because it has become so solid in recent years?
ああ、何かな、ちょっと難しいな。
難しい。
なんだろうな。
でもいつも考えてる。それ。
うん、いつも考えてますね。だからなんかこう人間は何にこう惹かれちゃうのかなみたいなものをずっと考えてるんですよね。
人間は
何に惹かれるか、うん、例えばこう動いてるものとかってこうどうしても見ちゃうじゃないですか、わーってそういうものっていうものをがやっぱりこうそういうのを引きつけられてあの何かするさせるとかね、そういうようなきっかけをいつも、うん、使ってますね。
So maybe I guess on a pretty high level, but my game design philosophies, one of them is I'm constantly looking at things or I guess am triggered by things. What attracts our human maybe eyes or just humans in general? So, you know, whether it's in just an everyday environment or moving objects, it's like, what are we attracted to? What is appealing to us?That's what I'm always thinking of.
Yeah, he has a talk that you can see from Digital Dragons in Poland, where he really outlines...
これでいいかな?
よくできた。
あ、素晴らしいね。
We should save this.
Yeah.
Save the menu, ね。
yeah, save that. Yeah. But you can watch his talk, and it goes through each step of his philosophy for game design through a Unity tutorial that he made, and it just starts from like, here's a bouncing thing. Now make it red. Now make it move. Now change the physics so there are three bouncing things, and they're doing something weird. And if you drop something into this situation, everything changes. It's really like it's great.
これね、なんかちょっとペンが変だよ。
So now it's Yasuhara's turn to do it. Let's see. So in the meantime, I will ask Oshima-san. I don't have much time. I gotta be quick. Yeah. Oshima-san, which.Anime or animation were most influential on your animation creation for? It looks very Disney.
一番影響受けてるのは、
ちょっと。
Yeah, Disney でしょ? Yasuhara-san, それ何? 何でしょうか、それ?
ルパン三世。
Lupin the Third.
Oh, Lupin the Third.
Lupin the Third.
That makes sense. Yeah. Good buddies. Okay. We Yay. Might. We have time for like two questions, maybe. So if you line up to those mics, we can take them. All right, you're first. You stood right up.
Great panel. Thank you very much for your time. Real quick. What lessons did you take from the mascot kind of characters that came specifically from Sega, Alex Kidd and the like? I can't imagine you're working in a vacuum before coming forward and saying, all right, we're trying essentially again. And that might not have been your attitude from where you were coming from, but just curious about that part of the generation process. Thank you.
Alex Kidd のことを今聞いた。 It was like a little...It was hard to hear.
So the question was, what influence did you take from existing Sega IP characters like Alex Kidd, if anything?
だけどあのね、フリッキーっていうゲームがあったじゃないですか。
フリッキーは
ソニックに出てるんですよ。
Yeah, so the Flickies are in Sonic and they took some influence from that.
Yeah, they took some influence from that, but they're like, really nothing in particular from the previous characters that Sega had at that time. This was like really from scratch. It was like a white, you know, board ready for us.
So far as I know, it was like, let's redefine Sega.
Right.
Okay, we'll go to this side.
Yeah. Hello, thanks for the panel. Just really quickly, how do you feel that while Sonic was popular worldwide, it completely exploded in America and in Japan was popular but not as much? Do you feel that you may need it to, or looking back, do you feel that you could change something, or maybe you did something different?
なんでしょうね、あの基本的にアメリカ向けに作ったっていうのはあるんですよ、でテイストなんか もう大島さんね、アメリカのものに近づけようとして努力してたりしましたよね、なんかね、
はい、
うん、まあ、カートゥーンなんかを見て、うん、それはやっぱりちょっと日本のテイストとはまた違うですね、やっぱ正直、うん、
So our target from the beginning was to actually create this character that would appeal to the North American audience. So that was already part of the process. We weren't looking at trying to appeal to the entire world. On top of that, I had mentioned in our presentation that Oshima-san was very into like the airplane nose art, something that had a lot to do with US-based, American-based kind of culture at that time. Or of that era. So I think it was natural for us to have come up with something that would appeal to the North American audience rather than Japanese audience.
Oh, thank you.
多分一番はセガオブアメリカが我々を信じてくれたことが一番でかいと思います。Oh. だからアメリカで一番ヒットしたんだと思います。
Oh. I cannot leave this room today without mentioning that I think the biggest, I guess, factor is that Sega of America were so confident in what we were about to do and what we were about to embark on. And so the fact that they trusted us and believed in us and our work, I think was something that kind of validated, was a validation for us, but then they took that and really...worked it, you know, into their strategy. So that probably had a lot to do with how popular Sonic became out here.
Thank you.
Okay, so it's 4:30. We gotta wrap this up. But thank you all
thank
so much
so
for coming,
much.
And we'll try to go to the wrap-up room.
Sonic Mania.